is beneficial use of dredged material. Can soil sales save Peoria Lake? So by coming from the Army Corps of Engineers. So just before we start, a few housekeeping. So you've all, everybody who's joining through their computer sound have been automatically muted. If you joined the sound through the phone, please mute your phone. We have over 60 people registered. So because of that, we try to have all attendees line to remain muted throughout the webinar. And we're going to take questions, written questions. So if you have any questions, please type your question in the little chat box. If you click on the chat icon on the bottom left of your Skype window. So then once the presenter will be done with his presentation, we'll be asking him the questions. We're going to do our best to take all questions or comments during the webinar. If you have to leave the webinar before we have gotten to your question, we encourage you to review the webinar recording that will be posted on our website to hear your question and answer at a later time. You can also contact us and we send the questions by email through to our speaker. If you experience lag time in the presentation or if the slides are taking a long time to load, try closing unnecessary programs during the webinar. So on that, I'm gonna hand the speaking right to our friends in Chicago. And Jennifer and Chuck, it's your turn.
Okay, thank you. So hi everybody, I'm Chuck Theiling. Recently moved to Vicksburg, Mississippi from Rock Island, Illinois, where I was with the Corps of Engineers for 17 years. And I've been up on the upper Mississippi my whole career since about 1990. I got involved in beneficial use. I've been in ecosystem restoration and then watershed management for a long time. I got involved in this beneficial use investigations when I was looking over our dredging team's shoulders, and I noticed that they were planning their work in a circle about as long as a dredge hole reaches. And I'm a geomorphologist in the second training, and it just didn't look right to me that they were constraining their thought processes so narrowly to the length of the equipment they were working with. When I was looking at it, it was more of a question of where is the sediment coming from and where is it trying to get to and how can we help it along its way. So as we all know, there's certain sediments that are going to pile up in places we don't want them, and we're going to have to dredge and do some active management to do something with that. So we end up with large stockpiles of material along the river. So that's what I began to think about. What could we do with that? So I don't have enough to talk for a full hour, so I think there'll be plenty of questions. I'll slow down my talking. I usually talk way too fast. So I'll do as good as I can to slow down a little bit. So this is going to focus on the Illinois River Valley, where the root of our problem is glacial outwash. We are a glacial environment, and we've got glacial till forever and ever. It's all a result of these glacial outwash events from the upper Great Lakes regions. We'd have ice dams form, they'd break, and they'd just send whooshes of sand and water and everything all down these rivers, carved the Illinois River Valley, carved the Kankakee River, left these moraines. Can you guys see my mouse up there? Oh, yeah, good. So we have all these glacial till moraines, and the rivers all through here are cutting right through them.
Hey, Chuck. I apologize for interrupting, but we're not seeing the slides as you go through them. If you go to the box directly above the presentation, it should say take over as presenter.
Present now?
Yeah, you should be seeing a little box directly above your slide deck that says take over as presenter. And if you go ahead and click on that, you'll have control of the presentation. Perfect. There you go.
Sorry about that.
No problem at all.
All right. Well, let me back up so you guys can see those pictures. That'll fill some of the time I wasn't going to fill. Now the light on the slides is a lot slower, so we'll put up with that. Okay. So there's a mountains of glacial till that we have all over here. And then this will give you an image of what the glacial outwash events look like. We've got masses of water leaving all these different moraines across northeast Illinois and Indiana. that we have all these glacial till deposits, which are very deep deposits of mixed sand, loess, and other material. So when that gets eroded away and gets started transported through our river systems, it ends up in places where people don't always want it. Now, the Kankakee River here, we've been getting complaints. One of my earliest projects was to look at sand migrating from Illinois, from Indiana into the Illinois basin, into the nicer part of the Kankakee and the Illinois River. People complaining about sandbars still. In our Corps of Engineers navigation mission, our problems are really exhibited at the mouth of tributaries. Here in the Rock Island District, we have problems with the Mackinac River and the Sangamon River near Beardstown, Illinois. We have notoriously large stockpiles at the Mackinac. There's over a million cubic yards in these different stockpiles I'm pointing out. Mackinac or Beardstown is the same. We have several piles around there. And it's typical CDF kind of management. Our material is very clean. We're lucky coming out of the river down here. So we don't have a lot of contaminants or that kind of issue. So we can just push it around and put it within our fee title land pretty much how we'd like to. Problem is all those fee title lands are filling up and we need to find new areas. We also have problems with degraded ecosystems. This is a famous picture on the Illinois River down near the mouth of the Sangamon where this Mascouten Bay area was and Sangamon Conservation Area was a famous historic fishing and hunting area. There were some log jams and stuff back in the 40s and 50s that blocked the normal path of the river. And people asked us to channelize the Sangamon a different direction. And when we channelized the Sangamon a different direction, we brought all the sand and silt into Mascouten Bay, and it's one of our notorious examples of backwater filling on the Illinois River. You can see we've turned an entire 10,000-acre backwater area into a small lake. And there's a small boat harbor down here, which is of big interest to the city, trying to spur some economic development, and it's a federal project, so it gives us a federal interest in that area. So we're called to this area a lot, and there's a lot of problems in Beardstown, a lot of upset municipalities. And so that will, you'll see later why that drives us to start our work in Beardstown. So when I start to think about rivers as a geomorphologist, I realize that all this outwash is going to be a chronic problem for our navigation and ecosystem missions for a long time. So how are we going to adapt our activities to cope with that? And we've got to learn how the system works with the heavy sands being transported along the main channel and the fines being delivered to our backwaters where they cause different kinds of problems. And we're spending lots of money to manage these sediments independent of each other. Navigation mission doing its thing, ecosystem restoration mission doing its thing, all managing dredge material disposal. I think that we can integrate both these missions together and others with human-mediated blending of these dredged materials. And that's just going to take a little bit of organization and coordination to make it cost-effective for everybody. So, kind of step back and go through an outline for this talk after that very brief introduction. We'll talk about the chronic channel maintenance needs. We'll focus on adaptive management that includes consideration for river process and function. I'm going to talk about some headquarters-funded R&D opportunities that have gotten us to where we are now. And then I hope to demonstrate some success for alternative management into the future. And as I mentioned, I've been working on a reach-based approach for a lot of my career and trying to think of more than just the site as an individual entity. So when you think that way, you think, what are the needs for change? And the current plans are too site-specific. We have more frequent groundings and emergency dredging on my part of the river, at least. When our containment sites are full, we have coordination problems. And then we don't have anywhere to put our material, so it puts us into emergency action, so we're kind of allowed to do not the best job. And a lot of that limitation has become to funding, of course, and then when you look at the federal standard, it really complicates our opportunity. And then I think the biggest problem in the Corps of Engineers is still way too much mission stovepiping. And that's kind of why I hope the R&D world is going to help me overcome some of that. And even when I was at the district, there were opportunities to bring some opportunities for change into the program by accessing R&D research and development resources. Regional Sediment Management Program has been a big help to us. We can also go to the Engineering with Nature program. And right now, DEWR, Dredging Operations Environmental Research, is supporting a lot of my activity. I'll talk a little bit more about that RSM work in a minute. Again, you'll get sick of hearing me say mission integration, but these are the important focuses. Conceptual modeling. I got a nice conceptual model at the end, and I think it's really important. We learn in our environmental training how important conceptual models are. I think all the PDTs need to bring that to their mission area and understand the utility of communication that way. And then modeling these outcomes is very important. I love our modeling. We can do great things with that. We just need to model a little bit bigger than the simple questions we've been asking. Structured decision making can help us identify the questions we need to ask. And I really think that the benefit to the Corps of Engineers and the nation is identify all the co-benefits, the ecosystem goods and services, from looking at a different model. So this is our work that started with regional sediment management on the Illinois River. As I mentioned, we started in Beardstown because of the multiple issues they've had going back to since the Corps got on the river, really. I mentioned that we channelized their floodway, and that delivered sediment in a different way. They also have failing levees, so they want sand from our channel for one thing, but not necessarily for another. And, of course, they'd like for us to pay to where we put it where they want it. We've got all these navigation channel stockpiles. They're full, and new access sites are not really available. We're doing everything that we can to avoid adding additional pump capacity, booster pumps, on our dredge operation, because that really would drive our costs up. And then, of course, that big Sanginoy Conservation Area is right next to Beardstown. That is a huge, massive ecosystem restoration opportunity and need. So my partner at Rock Island District is Nicole Manasco, and I'm really glad I remembered to acknowledge her, because she's the one that started all this work in 2012 and 2014. And she was in operations. She's recently become the water quality chief, and it's a great position for her. But they were looking at pretty routine things. They're looking at how can we put together a watershed program to protect the bottoms, what kind of geomorphic monitoring do we need to do in terms of sediment transport, bank erosion, those sorts of normal things, what's our operational history, the nuts and bolts of the beginning of a study. And then in 2015, they brought me in to do some conceptual modeling and public meeting stuff, because we realized there's a social engagement issue down there. They were calling their congressmen routinely. They were yelling at us all the time. And I went down there, and we had one of my structured decision-making conceptual modeling workshops, and one of the most ornery stakeholders in the whole cadre stood up at the end of the meeting and said, "This is the best Corps of Engineers meeting I've ever been to." Ray made me extremely happy to make that friend. I always try to make friends with your worst enemy. It'll help you in the long run. And that one really worked very well. We also did a hydrologic 2D model of the lower 40 miles of the Sangamon, and we subsequently did some levee setback modeling to see if we could get sediment up on the floodplain, and that was very cool, but another story. And then our last increment of funding out of RSM funding on the Illinois River was in 2016. We wrapped up everything in a summary report. We focused on this beneficial use of the soil manufacturing mechanism, and we brought in John Marlin from the Illinois Hazardous Waste Research Center, and he summarized all of his mud to parks work, in which back in the early 2000 or in the 1990s, I believe, they took a bunch of dirt from Peoria Lake, mud from Peoria Lake, and put it on U.S. Steel Southworks in here in Chicago. It was a really nice brownfield restoration and a model that should have kept going instead of waiting till now. We did move that 2016 work from the Sangamon to the Mackinac River because there is a little bit more potential to get an active project there. And what we did was we described techniques that could be paired with channel maintenance activities. We identified, so that meant I went through a list of measures like we would in a standard feasibility study. Then as you trim your measures down, identified the most successful techniques that we would thought would be useful, and that was the soil manufacturing. And then we began to review all the pilot studies and permits and stuff that would be needed to make that happen. We hoped to develop a schedule and budget for a pilot, but we didn't really get there because they moved me to another site. But we did write a report describe how all this stuff could work in the future. And these reports, unfortunately, are unpublished. That'll be my opportunity at ERDC is to get covers on these things. But this is kind of the model that I came up at Beardstown. It's real simple. I like to be very simple in my communications. The whole basis of this right here is this core stockpile of sand. You know, this could be anywhere. It could be collected in any way. But you want to find some silt, native soil. You want to find some nutrients, whether it's manure or municipal biosolids is another excellent choice to reduce your operational costs. And then you begin to blend these things into mixed blends. You can have 80% sand, 20% sand, and the key is that you can make what you want, given that you've got all the material around. You go into any of our backwaters, you can find silt, you can find clay, you dig deep enough, you can find highly organic peat, because they're all former wetlands. Conversely, you're in Illinois, you could go to this cornfield, take the stover off the field, mix it with manure from here, and manufacture the exact same carbon nutrient ratio. You could go over into Sangamon Conservation Area over here and do timber stand improvement. We have trouble getting rid of our slash when we do timber stand improvement. It's all input fodder, carbon for the soil mix. And that's what's so cool about this. So in this rendition, I've got a bedload collector which sits on the bottom of the river, like on the Cuyahoga, you guys probably may be familiar with that, and then simply transport the sand off-site into a simple pile. No need to dredge the main channel anymore under that application, theoretically. Reduced cost of dredging, make stuff a lot more efficient, it would be great. And this one, too, I've got a topwater collector. Theoretically, we could collect silt off the top, send that clean water into an algal turf scrubber. I'm not going to talk about algal turf scrubbers, but they're really cool. They suck up nutrients and carbon, and they can give you a biomass that you could mix into your custom soil blend. So the point is that there's really tons of materials around to blend into useful stuff if you're thinking that way. And Minnesota Mulch and Soil started thinking that way about 15 years ago, 10 or 15 years ago. I'll be mentioning the name Marty Long several times, so if you hear me say Marty, I mean Minnesota Mulch and Soil. I had heard about this operation many, many years ago, just casually offhand from the operations chief in St. Paul District, casually mentioning there's a guy that makes dirt out of manure and sand with the University of Minnesota. And then I plugged that away in the back of my brain, apparently, and when I found that I was having issues with how they were dredging, I said, well, why don't you make dirt out of that? There's a guy doing it in St. Paul, and that RSM funding, you know, $10,000, $20,000 at a time. I have not been funded more than $60,000 on any of this over 3 years, by the way. But that, over time, built a relationship, and Marty's taught us how we can make soils, how we can blend these materials together, and how the private sector can make oodles of money off of that. I'm not going to talk about it too much, but they did a review of his business operations and found the 30% margin. And I'm not a business guy, but they were telling me that 5-6 is pretty darn good, and they were amazed at 30. And that's because, as I talk about, you get paid to take the garbage, you get paid to mix it together, you work on free pre-lease property, and you sell it. And it's just a great deal. So, pictures of inputs. Here's carbon, here's sand, here's a mix of organic materials, all blended together, give you a nice little black dirt mix on the outside. I always talk in these little conceptual models, and it's really as simple as this. We've got our dredged material. Cities have municipal treeways. That's Davy Tree Service, Asplund, all those really big ones. They generate huge amounts of organic waste. In our part of the world, we've got agricultural byproducts. Then you'd also have manure and our backwater sediments. All of these things are cost to each of these industries. If we blend them together into a soil blend, we should be able to reduce their cost of disposal at the same time we're recycling material into a marketable, valuable product. So I'll show you some. Well, I'm glad I moved slides around, so I may be a little bit out of sequence with my thinking process, but this is where it all comes from. I call this now the Minnesota model, and the state of Minnesota is very progressive in their water protection, akin to California and their air quality many years ago. I would like Minnesota to jump out as the protector of water quality. And this right here is a really good demonstration of it. The Pollution Control Agency told the Department of Transportation to reduce runoff in order to naturalize hydrology in our streams, because your increased runoff is causing erosion in our streams that's filling in Lake Pepin. That's systems thinking, and that's what I really liked about this whole approach. So what they did was they began to look at their systems and their shoulders and their ditches, and they realized that they could get a lot more infiltration if they changed the material. And I'm not a road builder, but I learned that in the past, they would typically just scrape material from the side of the road to wherever they needed it, and they'd just use whatever's locally available. And then when the farmers decided they didn't want to give up their soil anymore, then they started taking sub-quality material from whatever would come in. So people would be selling them their garbage, and they'd be wanting fine dirt, and they'd get crushed rubble. And, you know, so they said, we can get our act together on this. And in this tiny, tiny print is that's blown up bigger somewhere later where you get to actually read it. But it is requirements for the soil that they want. We want 70 to 80% sand. We want this amount of organic matter, and we want this amount of nutrients in order to grow the grass, get infiltration, and reduce runoff overall, contaminants and water. And it worked really well. They worked together with Minnesota Mulch and Soil, the University of Minnesota Ag Department Vet School, and the PCA, or the Department of Transportation. And they've been doing it for a long time. They've gone from roadsides to all sorts of stormwater applications. Marty's working with a bunch of big A&E firms on brownfield remediation and contaminants remediation. The bioremediation qualities of compost are phenomenal. And they know how to put different additives in there to make them do different things. So it really can get very scientific. Yet at its root, it's very basic. When I was asked ERDC for funding to do this, they said, Chuck, that's not science. We know how to do that. And I was discouraged for an hour, and then I realized, well, this is marketing. And I just turned my thought process around entirely and says, okay, I can do marketing better than I can do science anyways. So that's what we started to do. We started marketing the Minnesota model. And I visited Marty on vacation because, like I said, I got $60,000 over 3 years. But it was a nice trip. Went fishing and had some fun, too. This is his place. Over on the left is the Ramsey County Prison, where he gets free land and prison help to help him make compost. And it's an anti-recidivism program where they contribute to work training in the prison system in exchange for rent. This one over here is the St. Paul Municipal Harbor. They've got some dredging operations that are leasing in there, and you'll see some pictures where this was all just one big historic dredging stockpile. This is Marty's operation. The sand is a little bit off picture in a big pile over here, and it decants into this pool when it comes in wet. This little wetlandy looking thing is all the fines that are just drying. So when you need your native soil and your fines, they're all just sitting there. The sands come from the channel. The fines come from harbors and terminals and that sort of thing, locks, cleanouts, that sort of thing. And then back in the background, you can see his little operations there. And so here's this is all the drying the materials there. Here's the input stockpiles of sand and peat and different things. And then on the other side of the yard, you've got your custom inventory. So you simply take the inputs, you put them into a blending drum, and move them over to the other side of the yard and load them into trucks. It's not terribly complicated, but it's really effective. And so this is what the site looked like in 2003. You can see it's a great big dredge site, or dump site, as we call them. 2004, they began to clean up the operation, and Marty told me that that was actually somebody else that tried and failed. Then they loaded her up with sand a couple of more times, and Marty took over. And I show this picture because we can see a substantial pile of sand in September of 2009. This is May of 2010. The sand is nearly gone, and the site is even more cleaned up than it was. So it shows you how quick material can go. Right now, Marty's cranking out about 50,000 yards a year, easy capacity of 115,000 a year. And we know that the market can only get bigger. You may have heard about Wabasha, Minnesota in the news. That's one of our biggest problem areas in the Upper Miss right now. We think we can take all that material and market it between Minneapolis and Wisconsin, and they're getting 270,000 yards a year. So then when the site's really good and cleaned up, the city can really take over. They came in and built a terminal that they can lease out for even more money. Marty's operations can be reduced down to about 6 acres, and everybody's happy. Right now, he's complaining that he can't get enough sand because we don't deliver it on the regular enough occasions, and we don't deliver it. It's the barge companies doing him a favor when they put it there, and then he pays $2 a yard. So it's a nice operation. So then what do you do with the stuff once you've got it all made? I mentioned the Minnesota model. Here's the words you can actually see. Provide manufactured soil for use as a medium for treating and filtering stormwater in rain gardens, or filter berms, dikes, bioswales, etc. It's all in their Minnesota specs books. They have three different blends in there currently, and like I mentioned, you can make any material you want. We're hoping, well, I'll talk about Peoria Lake later. So highways are the biggest user. Marty always talks about you will not sell this stuff at Walmart. Don't think about bagging it because they don't use it, enough of it. You need to get the highways and construction. I think stormwater management is our future. We don't even, when you look at the beneficial use of taking the sand out of the river and putting it up on the upland where it will capture the water, it just makes sense to do it that way. Ecosystem restoration can benefit in several ways. We can use the sediment that we're dredging. Then we can make it better for revegetation. I don't know if you guys build islands in your work, but on the Mississippi River, we'll build the sand base and cap it with fines. I personally believe we'd be better off if we built the whole island out of the same material or different materials, because it just doesn't seem natural to have sand and a layer cake like that. But then, as I mentioned earlier, this disposal for timber stand improvement, because you know, one dredging guy is complaining about getting rid of this, and an ecosystem manager is complaining about this, and a forest manager is complaining about that, and I'm the only one that talked to all three of those guys and found that out. So that's what you got to do. Brownfield remediation in these urban areas is going to be a big business, and really for your slightly contaminated materials where you've got higher tolerances in urban areas, that's what you want to do. Where you got really clean material, you can send it to a farm field or something else, like or a playground. Same thing with contaminants. And I got to emphasize the waste recycling as a savings. We were just working with the city of Ottawa, I'm going to talk to about in a minute. They're spending $300,000 on organic waste management. We're convinced that we can bring them down by half easily. We can also incorporate municipal biosolids from sewage plants, all these agricultural byproducts, manure, and, of course, our dredge material, saving everybody money along the way. So really what it is, like I said, it's marketing. It's matching these sources, markets, and missions to increase the efficiency across all these sectors. And I took out my Donald Rumsfeld picture as much as I hate to do it, but... you know what you know and what you don't know. and I know that this is low risk, low cost, high impact. Unfortunately, the Corps of Engineers is often in this box where we're fighting the fire and the latest challenge. We need to get over here. If we want sustainability to work, we got to be thinking in the box of sustainability, and that's low risk, high impact, not fighting the biggest fire all the time, waiting for disasters to happen. I don't see a risk to any operations manager supporting this. It's going to be, I got to ERDC and I found out that the district doesn't want to send money away. But people are going to have to start investing in innovation if you want to save money in the long run. And I suppose that's my R&D high horse, but I think it's true. Okay, so this is going to be a rundown of the operation that we're planning at Bulls Island. It's near Ottawa, Illinois. The problem here is the Illinois River doesn't carry much flow through this part of the river. And when it hits this island, the flow split drops river energy and the sand's dropping out in our navigation channel. So we dredge every year here about 20,000 cubic yards. So when we make a plan for 20 or 40 years, we need to be looking at enough area to store 500 yards of material, and that ends up to be 25, 50 acres. This is our current site right now. It's a small site. It's full. It's been full. When we run out of space there, we do emergency placement along this bank line. You can see if we put it along that bank line where it's likely to go. Yes, right there. So that's not the best option. So the dredging team is beginning to identify parcels of land where they could open a new storage site. And their really preferred one is this area up here, which is going to be in conflict with some other ideas. Now, I mentioned the slide I copied. This is the slide I copied by accident. There's supposed to be a slide in here that says a little wider view. If you go upstream from here a mile, there's one of the nicest ADM fleeting terminals you ever saw in your life. There's a great big huge mulch stockpile where they bring cypress hardwood mulch from Louisiana to this point and then distribute it all over Chicago. First time I saw that mulch pile, I thought, hey, that's a nice blend for my dirt. But then they told me the value of that and said, well, we're not going to charge that much. But it was interesting to know that they can bring wood chips from Louisiana and sell them in Chicago for a profit. You know, that's a long way to bring chopped trees. And so it gave me hope that we could move stuff from Chicago to Ottawa. And with that really nice terminal fleeting facility you can't see, we can do it. And when we began to talk to ADM, they were very open to the idea of us bringing our material directly to their site, using their efficient onloading and offloading. They would lease some of their land to a contractor that would do the work. So we may not need to acquire a new CDF. We may just need to acquire a new partner and drive our stuff rather than the 10,000 feet of a dredge hose with a hydraulic dredging operation. With 20,000 yards, that's easy to go to a mechanical operation and bring in another mile on a dredge. So that's the kind of feasibility study that we can do as a clear cost comparison. Moving at this distance versus that distance, using this method versus that method. You can do the real feasibility work we do in our job. Now, when we look downstream from our site, a little closer to the city of Ottawa, you see our site right here. You see, the city of Ottawa already has a plan for the place that we think is our ideal CDF. So it's not going to be the locally preferred plan. And that's always a problem. You know, we don't want to condemn, especially against the city. But then you look a little bit farther downstream to their riverfront, and they want to build a great new riverfront park that could use all the material that we could ever make. So there's a compatibility in here if you just begin to look it around. And that's what I'm encouraging people to do, is look at the compatibilities. Timing is always an issue, of course. Getting a person to build the road at the same time you want to get with sand is a huge challenge we run into all the time. But, you know, if the opportunities are there, they'll present themselves and people will think about them. And then I began to think of Chicago as a market and Chicago as a resource. All these sewage plants in Chicago and all these people in Chicago are generating a lot of waste. Metropolitan Water Recommendation District, MWRD, is one of the biggest sewage treatment operations in the world, and they put a lot of money into this. They have a lot of capacity to move a lot of material like you wouldn't believe. This machine here is a windrow turner. I've never seen one before. I got there and they have two of them, and they're huge. And these are to turn the compost windrows that they blend their wood chips and biosolids into, which is the perfect material for us to mix our sand into. And like I said, they're spending oodles of money to manage this stuff. We're spending oodles of money to manage our stuff. I think if we come together on these waterways with efficient barge transportation, we can save a lot of people money and do a lot of good work in the environment. So then we began to, who would you market to in Chicago? And look, lo and behold, next to the sewage treatment plant is a huge highway system. So we called the tollway. And the tollway was very receptive to our conversation. And when we said we could give you a material at a penny pound, they got even more receptive to our conversation. And turns out they've already done a lot of the work. They've done a lot of the regulatory work on Chicago CDF material. They've already done the regulatory work on the biosolids, which was a really nice surprise. And they seem to be way more advanced than Illinois Department of Transportation as far as I can tell right now. So I think I chose a good partner, and I chose them because they have money and the state of Illinois doesn't. And then I began to look a little wider, and I don't know anything much about Loyola other than I found this really nice graphic on the webpage. But I do know that Chicago has really bad stormwater management problems and a lot of really big brains around here. And I think if we can provide the material, we can quit thinking about engineered ditches underground and start thinking about dirt and natural approaches to this. Now, there's always going to be a hardscaping need, you know, in dense urban areas, but there's also going to be a creative way to get more naturescaping in that picture too. So that's what we'll try to get people to do. Brownfield remediation, I don't think I need to beat that too much, other than if you're not familiar with mud to parks, just Google mud to parks, you'll enjoy it. We have a new report coming out. In fact, we can email a link out to a brand new report later on. It's coming out of the University of Illinois. I'm in Iowa, used to be in Iowa, and I really want to work with farmers because they get a bad rap. We're all pointing fingers uphill saying you're doing your job wrong and you're sending your dirt and your nutrients down to me. Well, they're often people trapped in a system, and I want to help them get out of that system, and there's a lot of people within that system that want to help themselves. And the Soil Health Initiative or Soil Health Partnership can really be that. I wanted to talk to them about getting biochar in their systems and stuff, but I really think, thinking about my system and agricultural levee districts, I've got a million cubic yards of dirt sitting in a pile, and I've got 10,000 acres of floodplain levee districts subsiding and sinking into the floodplain. I don't know who's going to pay the cost of moving material around, but it might be more cost effective to move 100,000 yards of material over 10,000 acres than 100,000 yards of material and 100 acres in a big pile. If we can add carbon to it, if we can add nutrients to it, if we can make garbage useful to agriculture, we can get the soil help. I was amazed to find out, talking to a dairy farmer in Iowa, that he was carbon limited. Because of the way they over-fertilize with manure, they get this huge nutrient imbalance, and the carbon is going off in the crops, so our farmers are carbon limited. Yeah, Jennifer's eyes are wide open, just like mine were that day. It's like, no. But it's true. So that brings me closer to the end, a couple slides left. And this is a simple model. We've got our problem, which are these piles of aggregate in different places around the river. We've got partners who have excess nutrients. We have partners who have excess carbon. And all those three things right there are the ingredients to dirt. We can just put those together and find a way to get things from rural areas to urban markets, I think we can solve a lot of our problems. And we find out that even in these little areas, this little town like Ottawa, we could probably use all this material up just in that one spot. But where we have a million cubic yards and we have 10,000 acres of silt in Peoria Lake, we need a market like Chicago, we need a market like St. Louis, I think, to support that. I'm going to a meeting on Thursday, which is going to be a ton of fun at the University of Illinois. There's a modeler who does network optimization, where we can look and see what's the most efficient way and mode of moving this thing from that place to get it from here to there. I've read some of his papers, and I can't wait to outline this model with him and dig into it, because I think that's going to show us a lot of what we need to know about the efficiency of this market. So, can soil sales save Peoria Lake? We'll find out. Right now, in these teeny tiny charts, you'll see that Peoria Lake has very little depth below the blue lines and the black lines, and it's a great big lake. That's not what Peoria looked like before we did the diversion from Chicago in 1900 and the dams on the Illinois River in the 1930s. Before, what we had was a marsh and with a river running through it. And we think that this model is more appropriate for the future, and that there's ways that we can get to that model through this beneficial use. So we're thinking about several different management measures, and we put them into an alternative. And this is just one called Barrier Island Management Areas. What we would do in this model, we would manage sediments coming in from the watershed, collect them, capture them, turn them into something. And with that, we would build barrier islands. The barrier islands then would reduce wind and other disturbances into the backwater, which we think would then promote a better aquatic ecosystem back there. We can dredge deep water to get the fines, and we can do everything we can in these little areas to create opportunities from the materials generated from the restoration activity. And ideally, if we have a market for that, the sales of the soil will pay for the restoration. We think there's just a need for a kickstart to get this going, and we're looking for that. I don't know if it says I have more slides, but I don't think, oh yeah, the keys to success. I'm gonna back up a second. So I wanna talk just a second about 1122 projects. Everybody's heard about these Corps of Engineers, 1122 beneficial use dredging things. The Peoria Lake team, I'm on a study, planning assistance to state, developing a comprehensive plan for Peoria Lakes right now. And we just turned in a proposal to do this commercial soil manufacturing as an 1122 project. We don't think that this is centric to Peoria Lake at all. We think that it would serve everybody if we can get this one funded and operationalized. We have a great partnership that's developed. Up in Ottawa, we have ADM, we've got a local soil manufacturer, we've got Minnesota Mulch and Soil, we've got the City of Ottawa. But what's really nice and really encouraging to us is that we've got Caterpillar Corporation as a lead on a natural infrastructure initiative. It's a consortium of Caterpillar, the Nature Conservancy, AECOM, and several other large A&E firms. And they recognize the value of natural infrastructure or nature-based inventory when they watched the Corps working after Hurricane Sandy. And now they want to take that worldwide. I was fortunate to bump into these guys and show them my story in November, and they said they hadn't seen anything this advanced. So I think we're really in a forefront of this. I see activity like this all over the place. I know I'm not the only one doing this, but I hope that we can orchestrate our activities together so that we're all pulling on the same rope. So I think that the keys to success are to develop conceptual and economic models that regular people will understand, share ideas broadly, and build partnerships. That's why I'm here today. I caught something in the news about your General Toy and Lakes and Rivers Division about all this Ohio stuff that seemed very encouraging to me, and he seemed like he could be a real advocate. And I'm not afraid of a little competition. I'd like to put my general up against your general to see who can do a better job. And I know they like that too. And maybe that's the way we need to think. You guys may not agree, but what I see in the news most often is this bedload collector in the Cuyahoga. I work with those guys. That thing is very exciting to me. I know the other things that are going on in Ohio a little bit, and they're very interesting. I know of some work in the Great Lakes up near Duluth. but I'm not familiar enough with any of those, and I'd like to become. But that makes me think that there's variations on this theme all over the nation, because you're going to have different input materials. I'm going to go down to Florida, I'm going to have algal muck. I'm going to go to the coast, I'm going to have coastal sand. I'm going to go to, every time Marty looks at our sand from a different part of the river, it's slightly different in Minnesota than Illinois, and upper Illinois is better, different than lower Illinois. So that's fun and exciting. And then my key is to capture all the ecosystem benefits. And I think that if we can target a penny a pound, anybody in the private sector is going to be thrilled with that cost, because it's a better product at a lower price, delivered where you want it. I think that's it. Yeah, I did put a couple of slides in about the bed load collector if you want to talk about that, but we'll get to that. I'll stop and take questions now, I think.
Well, thank you, Chuck. That was a really great presentation. I think we're learning a lot from what you talked about today. I had a couple of questions here. The first one was, if a chemical is measured in the sediment, how do you convince public and stakeholders that there is no risk? And how do we prove that the sediments can be used beneficially?
Well, there's way, it depends, of course, what the contaminant is. Some are easier to get rid of the others. But we believe that the common organic compounds can be remediated pretty effectively in these compost mixes. So we have the science to demonstrate that, and we can show that and put up the best evidence, and then I think just put it out on the streets and let people respond to it. But I think there's plenty of science that shows we can do it. Another one?
That was muted.
Yeah. So it's just a question of bringing the science to the public then.
Yeah, I think so. Well, and bringing examples to the public and backing it with the science.
Yeah, thank you. I had a question. Well, it was kind of comment, half question. So someone said that there's serious potential to spread non-native and invasive species when applying mulch and wood chips from one part of the country to the other one. For example, that person I've heard about avoiding using mulch from Louisiana in the upper Midwest because of the spread of non-native and invasive species. So how do you, so if you, like, for example, if you want to use material from Illinois, from Prairie Lake, and bring to Chicago, how can you avoid the spread of the invasive species?
I think that's a really interesting question. And with regard to some of the invasive species, we can help eliminate them. I was concerned about emerald ash borer because Mississippi River, a third of the trees are ash. And when those things come through, all we're going to have left is ash maple trees. And then we're going to get Asian long-haired beetles, and we have no trees. But my point is that we can, through this process, we could mulch up those ash borers, and it's been proven as an effective remediation even against the larvae. I appreciate the idea of moving seeds and stuff around. That's not my bag, but, you know, if you keep your stuff local in this local market, then it's not going to be an issue. And I don't think any of this stuff is that valuable that you're going to ship it a long way. And that's my point, is that the money is made local. The less you move this stuff, the better, and the less you touch it, especially touch it once, is the biggest rule of this business.
Yeah, definitely. I had another question, previous question. I think when during your slides about Bull's Island, if I'm not mistaken, someone was asking, wasn't there a recent NEPA document about this?
About the soil use?
I don't, okay. The question was just, wasn't there a recent NEPA document about this? Maybe the person who has a question, if you want to.
Well, you know what? I can just respond generally on NEPA, because we were talking about that in Rock Island District quite a bit. And a lot of it depends on whether it's a federal action or not, and whether you open up your site and somebody comes and takes the material, or whether we take the material off our site and give it to a person. So the legalese of this gets very arcane in regards to who has ownership. And it's really interesting, but what we found recently is 2016 WERDA, section 1153, it's like gives the commander the capacity to let people come onto our fee title land and do work for us if it's going to save us money. So then if we can document the legality of it, the regulatory acceptability of it, then the commander can say yes, and then real estate can use a common vehicle that says the commander said this is good for us, so we can let you on our land. That just came to my eyes a couple of weeks ago, and we ran it by our real estate chief, and that was good. But NEPA is a problem. I mean, somebody's going to take ownership for that material along the way, and we can manage whether it's the Corps' responsibility or somebody else's, and that's going to be our due diligence as planners.
Mm-hmm. I had a quick comment here from someone saying you can contact NRRI if you want to come to go to Duluth. They have been working with the Army Corps of Engineers on beneficial use of dredged materials, and they would enjoy the opportunity to meet.
Sounds like fun. I'll come during ski season and summer season.
Another question just came in. Chuck, have you worked with the Army Corps of Engineers, Buffalo District, and or are aware of the Cleveland Harbor beneficial use projects?
No, but I'll write it down and I'll look it up. I am familiar with a few people over in Buffalo.
And I was at the WEDA, the Western Dredging Association Midwest chapter last week. And yeah, there were really great things from Cleveland. So I think it's really worth looking into, as the person just commented.
Excellent. I will look that up. And Jen says she's got a list of people that'll help me out too.
Great. And I have a contact here. I can also send him your his email. Does anyone have any more questions? We will still have a few minutes left before the end of the scheduled webinar. So if you have any questions, last chance. I think you did too much of a great presentation. Nobody...
Well, you know, let me add one thing that I had a note that I meant to say. The city of Peoria is also setting up a water utility, and we think through that we can use the watershed to support the restoration of the lake. And as I mentioned, if we can use the lake to restore the runoff, we can reduce the cost of the utility tax in the long run. It's going to make a great beneficial use model if we can convey that kind of message. So thank you for this opportunity. I really appreciate it.
Well, thank you for presenting with us today. Chuck, is there an email where we can reach you?
Yeah, it's charles.h.filing@usace.army.mil.
Perfect. I'm going to make sure I send this email around to the attendees. So if it's okay with you, of course, if they want to contact you and have any more questions. And I have a few people here who sent me some contact information that I'm going to make sure I send to you, Chuck.
Great. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. And again, we're going to try to post a recording of the presentation online. For those of you who don't know us as much or don't get all my emails, the Great Lakes Dredging Team annual meeting will be held on May 22nd, 23rd in Toledo. We should be sending the information pretty shortly. For the venue and details on the agenda. So stay aware of these emails. And if you're interested in knowing more about the Great Lakes Dredging Team and the work we're doing, please feel free to send us an email, and we'll be happy to give you more details. Well, on that note, have a great day, everybody, and thanks for joining us.
Thank you.